I always remember the first day was not good because I'd gone in there and the columns were upside down. All the columns, and I'd seen it, I'd even drawn it for him, saying like this, and I'd put the weight at the top.
He basically said, well, the only thing I'd like to do is turn the columns upside down. And I looked at him incredulously, like, what do you mean, turn them upside down? And he said, just that, put that down here. I said, okay.
And the columns are not supporting the ceiling, but they're just big bastards. I said, look, without damaging the floor, how long to cover the floor without scratching it? Turn each column over. He said, you won't be shooting until 12 o'clock.
I went to the first AD, told them, this is at 7 in the morning, come back at 2 o'clock, and we'll be ready to shoot. The director wants a change.
Sure made hell for the construction crew, you know, because they had to come in here, and, you know, there's all block and fall stuff. Turn them around, boom, like that. And then the floor, God, the amount of time they spent polishing this floor and just waxed, and they could not get the really high gloss, and then they pull it out. And so each square was like 2x2, and they were polishing those things.
At 2 o'clock in the afternoon, when everybody came back from lunch, Ridley was a happy camper. The columns were upside down. Everything else was in place, and they shot.
It was worth turning the columns over, because otherwise all that stuff would have been at the top of the shot.
Those eyes are one of a kind. It's like Rutger's character. It's like, if you could see what I could see with my eyes, you know? That's Ridley Scott. And Ridley was very demanding. I mean, from the point of view of the lighting and the acting and the design. And I remember him saying, put more stuff on her lips. Put more stuff on her lips. Keep putting that stuff on her lips. No, 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 more. I'd heard later that Ridley wanted me to stay in my little cubicle dressing room because he didn't want me to have too much interaction with everyone. So, I mean, that could have been part of the manipulation.
Ridley, who also came from a lot of commercial background, was constantly trying to add a kind of scintillating visual stimulation to scenes. A good example would be in Terrell's office. And we're sitting there in this big set, and we're struggling with our part of it, which is the front projection out the windows. The live-action guys are struggling with the weird lighting stuff, and Ridley is saying, well, I want this light to be like, whew, you know, up against the wall. And we're saying, well, what's motivating that? Is it raining? Is the floor wet? And what's? And he says, no, it's just gotta happen. And so I thought, well, that's what Ridley wants. That's what he should have. And when you look at the movie, you do have to ask, well, what's all that about? Is that something coming in the window from some atmospheric thing going on outside? You don't need to explain it. But Ridley has always had this incredible sensitivity to all kinds of ways to create visual stimulation.
After the first day of shooting, Doc Erickson came to me and said, we're now 5 days behind, which was not what I wanted to hear, but I mean, Ridley was dealing with the smoke and the mirrors and the this and that and columns and so on and so forth. In the meantime, Harrison's just sitting there waiting to act and getting pissed off because he's not being called to the set to act in the scene.
The reason I was so thrilled about having Ridley is he's got the very best eye in the business. And that comes with a price, which is the time and the effort that he has to put into it. So he'd often be sitting up in the sky on a crane doing the last book on the table position when Harrison was sort of seething and not being told what to do. And Ridley didn't think it was necessary to tell him what to do.
Harrison always, up to this point, had been dealing with directors, for instance, like Francis Ford Coppola. Working with Steven Spielberg and working with George Lucas, there was a commonality among all three of them, which was all three of them very much pulled Harrison into the creative process of building that character.
Ridley felt that Harrison was perfectly capable of doing everything he had to do, knew how to do it. And Ridley, meanwhile, was composing the picture.
There's a part of you that wants to be totally in sync with the director's ambition. And then there's a perverse part of you that says, you know what? It doesn't really matter. What matters is being there and participating truthfully in whatever the relationships and the scenes are. And fuck it, it's just a movie. Let him worry about it.
Maybe Ridley was giving me more attention than he was giving Harrison because he was making the assumption that he didn't need that. Harry was never happy on that show. He never was. Not really. The only time he was happy was if it was going to be close to wrap, you know? Then he was happy.
In the case of the first property master who departed, it was over the mug on the desk in the Holden interview. The prop guy, you know, brought in like two or three pens and maybe three or four mugs, and Ridley wanted to see more. And he couldn't figure out, well, why would you want to see more? It's like only a mug and it's only a pen. I took the prop guy aside, I said, go buy like 100 mugs. Go buy like 100 pens. What do you care? Just go buy, don't you see what's going on here? Because I could see what was going on. He wanted to see every mug ever made before he chose that mug.
We had our man in Havana, so to speak, there on the set every day and watching it, and we saw some of the rushes. Bud was more involved, but Ridley's a perfectionist, and Ridley came from the world of commercial, doing commercials from England, and he was very, very successful.
And he's very meticulous, and that's what his genius is. And I don't take anything away from him, but it starts to slow down when you start to take many, many takes of certain scenes, and we did. We started out, we were a few weeks behind, within a few weeks, so it was, I thought things could start to take off.
I presume behind closed doors he started getting twitching, like after the first week of shooting, when we were like 2 or 3 days behind, and then after the first couple of weeks shooting Terrell's room, suddenly, you know, we went back and started reshooting them, and I would have thought he went apoplectic, because you know, they had put an X amount of money and they were guaranteeing completion. You know, Jesus, I mean, I would imagine him getting pretty irate.
I remember Ridley heard that they were upset at the number of takes he's done once when they were watching dailies, and Ridley got very angry. And in retrospect, I think Ridley was sending a message back to them in his own way. He was having a tantrum and stuff, and I think he was letting them know, don't fuck with me.
What I saw, I liked. I did think, and you know, when I told this to Ridley, you know, I thought he printed way too many takes those days, and shot too many takes. I didn't think he needed. I thought now obviously he was looking for something in everyone, and he and I sat actually a couple of times, and I said, explain to me, because I don't quite understand it. Tell me why this 16th take was the best one out of this whole group, and. He in his own way, he would explain why he wanted it. And there was a lot of film that was used.
Yeah, there'd be irritation. I'd do 7 takes, and why is he doing 7 takes? I know people do 40 takes, but 7 takes in those days was not inordinate at all. I was definitely very different. That's why I've done being very successful as a commercial maker, and would look at things in a different light and put things in a different way, so they hadn't seen that before. That's why you're hiring me. And I think that went on, definitely, and that's, you know, I acknowledge that.
Ridley is a very strong-minded, knows what he wants, knows the look. And when you're trying to do a project that's this different, and you've got the studio laddie on the one side, and then Ridley, and nothing ever gets made without having its difficulties.
All I remember when Ridley's making Blade Runner, anger. Anger at people not understanding his process or how he worked.
A lot of people don't bother to understand what is it that he's trying to do. And I think that's what happened at the time. There was a lot of nervousness, you know, and there was a lot of competition within themselves. And I think people made a lot of it in the beginning. Everybody already anticipated before shooting, oh, he's not gonna like us. He's gonna be unhappy with us because he thinks American crews are not good. I don't think he really sat there and said, I don't think American crews are not good. He wanted everyone to be at their best.
I realized I couldn't bring in the people I'm used to, because of the union. So I'm not lucky in the union, that's the way it goes. And so being new on the block here, I had to learn the process of, I couldn't use this, couldn't use that. You know, I'm used to being my own operator. There's nothing worse when you've done 2,500 commercials. And I know I've got a very good eye. In 3 seconds, I can give you a setup, having walked in a room without even seeing it before. So I don't like discussion. I know exactly what I want. I want to walk in and say, do it. That's the director's job. The director's not meant to stand there and consult with half a dozen people in the room. The term director means direct, mate. Do the job.
How are we working?
Hello. And what can he do for you?
Can the maker repair what he makes?
My first day was the scene with where I had to strangle my father or whatever I did to my father maker. And I'd never been on a production like this, you know, 250 people, had no idea who everybody was. You know, got there at 6 in the morning and seeing this develop so slowly and start to shoot a scene one day and end up with the scene being shot 3 days later, not knowing where you started again. It was a shock. But the great part about the shock was that, you know, there were some brilliant people at work. The DOP was wonderful to see him, how he would just paint, you know, with his light. And it took him hours sometimes.
Jordan came with his team, which I thought was fine because he's a great cameraman. And he came with two really good operators. And so I thought, well, I can't operate. I would line up as much as possible, though. I like to line up, so like that. That's what I do. That's what I know I'm doing. And that is more efficient and it's faster.
On any film, people get frustrated. And you have an artistic director that sees it his own way and he's definitely the one driving the show. Jordan wasn't in the best of health, so it was frustrating for him because he couldn't jump up and be with Ridley. He just wasn't physically able.
For a number of years, my father had suffered from a disease that we eventually found out was Parkinson's, that progressively through the course of the movie, it took its toll, and for the last month or so of the movie, he was in a wheelchair. Ridley, to his credit, saw past the illness and made a very bold choice in going with Jordan.
Intense, that's the best way to describe it. We had our scenes together. You have lived a very, very long life. I want more life and all. They were very intense. Looked him right in the eye, he looked me in the eye, we went at it, and it was great.
Rooker's naturally theatrical, in a good way. He understands the theater of it all.
Take five.
Oh, my heart.
Speed.
Hit camera on me, mark it.
I want more life.
The facts of life.
Then the whole kill, that was a major sort of a deal. Because they had made an extra sort of head, I think it was a $20,000 head of Terrell.
That was one of the prosthetics that was made, and it was made so that it could be crunched. They never used it. What we did is I ran some tubes up behind the ear, and when they did this, primitive, about as primitive as you can get. You know, a bulb and a tube and some blood, and the blood squirted.
Tyrell was a replicant as well. When he got his eyes squeezed out and his head squeezed out, nuts, bolts, springs.
And that was the idea that he was another front and another form of Nexus 6, I guess. And that would trigger me to go to the next floor. And in the next floor, in the pyramid of glass, would be, you know, Mr. Maker himself, dead for 4 years.
And so I had to design this sarcophagus, and Batty was supposed to be there looking at his maker, and I had him standing off to the right of the little painting I did with the sort of Mayan kind of capsule that he'd come out of, the entrance to the crypt. That was never filmed either.
Harrison was supposed to be having this on-screen love affair with Rachel. And Sean Young was very young and extremely inexperienced. And Ridley, I think, was more or less talking Sean through her performance to a certain extent. And Sean and Harrison just did not click on any level.
Anytime you're doing a love scene is tricky. First of all, I feel for the actors having to do it, saying it's really uncomfortable, you know. And you can't really let fly, let go, because that's not what you're doing. It's not very professional. And so it's a waltz. It's actually a delicate waltz to find out what should it be, how far should it go, and where's enough enough.
We scrapped an idea, Ridley did, where they put a piece of tape around my legs and they greased up my legs. And then it got all over the costumes and then it didn't work and they're trying to grab my legs and the whole grabbing leg thing and pulling my skirt up and getting it all over the costumes, people just complained and it just didn't work, so we scrapped it. So they cleaned my legs up and then we did something else. But then Ridley told him to push me. And I remember being really surprised about that. And I also remember Harrison being, I think I was crying afterwards too. And I remember Harry going to the side. Like, I was sitting on that ledge where the blinds were behind me, and we did the scene, and he went over to the corner there, and he turned away from me, and he took his pants, and he mooned me, because he was trying to make me laugh, because I was going, and I looked up, and he was mooning me. And I think I started laughing, you know, and I think what he was trying to say was, you know, hey, it's not that bad, kid.
Sean had a very interesting part to play, maybe one of the most interesting parts in the movie. She understood what was going on. She did, a good job.
Harrison was always the great technician. I mean, no, kid, you have to sit here. Your face has to be here. You have to be here. You have to move over that way. You know, back up, come here. He always knew exactly what to do and very much a technician in terms of lighting and talking. I remember we had a metronome that was supposed to sort of create a rhythm, and we had this metronome going, and he went over it and he went like that and he stopped it. I said, why'd you do that? And he says, well, I don't feel like looping it, kid, you know? And I was like, what's looping? You know, I had no idea of anything. So he was very much kind of teaching me making fun of me more, but, you know, pointing out my errors.
Harrison never left his dressing room unless he was shooting, so there wasn't a whole lot of interaction with any of us in Harrison and or Ridley in Harrison. And it did seem to, when Harrison came, he came prepared to work and that there wasn't a lot of dialogue. I think that's fair to say between the two. Maybe all of that unhappiness actually helped him, you know, to at least subliminally convey, you know, Deckard's own desperation and his own unhappiness with his own lot in life. Because Blade Runner, for better or worse, is one of Harrison Ford's signature performances. I think it's one of his best performances.
Harrison Ford is probably one of the smartest actors I've worked with. Top of the line, A, for what they can do, but B, they're able to do it because they're smart. That's not just intuition, they work it out, you know? Sometimes they don't comprehend what I do for a living on a big movie. My performance is important as any other performance of any person in that film, particularly the star. My film, the film that I make at the end of the day of my movie, it may be a team thing as well, but I'm taking the knocks, I'm taking the bashes, and probably I've developed it, et cetera, et cetera. So yes, it's my movie. And I'm inviting people to come in and do it, and that's what a director is.
I find it really easy and very encouraging to do what you feel. Go ahead. And then if you like it, you just smile. Be very happy, and maybe then if he liked it, he'd even ask you to do something else, you know, because that was fun. Let's do something further, you know. I can't imagine an actor not liking him.
Deckard, it's good to see you, old buddy.
Downtown LA, in front of the Bradbury Building, in the middle of the night, usually our call pretty much always was at sunset. We were vampire hours, you know. I was, you know, kind of buried in a pile of trash, much like the screen test, and kind of met J.F. Sebastian the first time. And also there was, of course, lots of rain. And so one time when I was kind of running away from J.F. Sebastian, I ran and hit the van, and my arm went through the window, and it wasn't breakaway glass, so I still have a scar. It's a little bit keloided, so you can see it. But I had like, you know, 8 chips or 9 chips taken out of there, and there's still some more floating around in there, I think, which didn't help doing the back walkovers and things on the chipped elbow.
I'd filmed in the Bradbury Building before, which is very pristine, very clean, an amazing place. Great ironwork and so forth that visually just is fabulous. And lit it for a set, you know, a lot of backlight. Again, had the xenons passing through and smoke. It was eerie. But the amazing part about it is I don't really think that the Bradbury people understood how Ridley wanted to do it, because it was a total mess.
In the interior, we had a 65-foot truck filled with debris, and we had, of course, rain inside the building. We had rain everywhere. And what we would have to do, because the building was occupied at the time, we could get it at 6 o'clock at night, and at 6 o'clock in the morning, we had to be out of there and it had to be clean. So because it looks like it's decrepit and filthy, we couldn't figure out a way at first, but then we came up with the idea if we took cork and crumbled up cork, because it has the same texture and color as mud and dirt. So we'd throw cork all over the floors, and the rain would absorb it, so the next morning when you swept everything up, it was like clean and didn't have to be scrubbed with soap and water, because we probably had no more than an hour to get out of the building every day.
When I first came onto the set, I walked on a lot through this maze and saw these signs and buildings and whatnot. I said to myself, wow, this is astronomical. It's gonna take forever to do this film if it hasn't already. I thought I was going to go to the studio and see a so-called refrigerated lab.
They shot it in a real fridge, basically, a monster fridge, let's say, and so it was frosty.
That was cold in that meat locker, boy. And I don't know how long it took before the cameras would freeze, but you had to really be in and out after maybe 20 minutes, half an hour or something like that, or else the oil would all freeze up in the damn things.
In a way, it was kind of strange why they did that, because the conditions were almost uncontrollable. They could not set the temperature of that freezer to where they could just get the cold and see the breath coming out, and everything looks frozen.
We started off with a couple of arcs in the freezer. Well, they're carbon arcs. They're actually burning coal. And after about an hour, people were sniffing around. And about another hour, people were starting to get ill, because we were, number one, taking the oxygen out of the air, and the smoke from the carbon, people were getting sick. We had to shut down the arcs and literally open up the freezer, get all the air out, had fans going.
The lights were not working, and then, you know, people were yelling what they're gonna do, and bring the lights out and the camera, and the producer was on to Ridley. That's good enough, you know, that's good enough, or whatever. I like I said, wouldn't want to work in that atmosphere again. It's just too much. Too much was at stake at too short a time.
Probably one of the most unique experiences on a backlot, for sure, that I've ever seen. All of the night scenes on Blade Runner, which were long, there were approximately 33 days of night. The night scenes were all shot on what's called the New York Street set. And this, of course, is where the Maltese Falcon had been filmed by Warner Brothers in the 1940s. And it was just their standing urban New York type of look.
To shoot a studio street on Blade Runner, you know, on the Warner's lot, would look crap. If you look at all the sort of TV series and things and see where they've shot on the studio street, and it all just looks like a studio street. So wetting it down and having things in heavy rain, you know, certainly started to bring it to life.
The reason why I could not have done those sets in daylight, they wouldn't have looked good. They would have looked pretty bad, and we would have had to spend more money. So by shooting at night, you save money, and it looks better. And it's always raining, it looks better. That's what it's about. And why is there always smoke? Because I haven't got enough money, it looks better. So those three elements are always my armory. Night, wet, smoke.
Someone on the crew once said that if you walked on the Blade Runner set, you felt like you were at a Pennsylvania coal mine. And it's very true, because the crew had all these white painter's masks on, and they had soot all over their face, and they had the little painter's goggles on, and everyone was tired, and it stank, and it was mildewed, and it was wet.
The smoke, ugh, they had beehive smoke.
Basically, you're looking for an urban area in 2020 that is just, the sun never shines, that perpetual fog and drizzle. Blade Runner had tons of atmospherics, a lot of it was at night, smoke and all. And the crew would be walking around with gas masks on because they've been breathing this stuff 20 hours a day, you know, for weeks and weeks and weeks.
I was outside a stage, it was full with smoke too, and Ridley come out to smoke his cigar or something, and I looked at him, I said, Ridley, do you have smoke in your house? He laughed. He said, no, not really, but you know, it was a very good effect.
I thought the art direction was brilliant, and the world that was created was very dense and interesting. Part of the look of the film had to do with the fact that it was shot outside at night, but it was a bitch working every night and all night long, often in the rain. So it wasn't the most pleasant shoot.
Action, please! Action, everybody!
Anybody that watches the picture knows that we were doused with water day in and day out. And that meant we had to have, you know, twice as many costumes, because how many times, every time they got soaked, you had to reshoot the damn scene again. You had to put on another costume. You couldn't wait to dry up.
There was always dialogue that we were behind schedule. I think it all culminated when we were shooting on the back lot at night with the street exteriors.
Never less than 13, 14 hours. We would shoot all night. Kind of the joke was, keep your eyes in the east, because as soon as you see that glow, you know we've got only about another hour.
Some days we never shot. And then some days we made two shots a day. One was on meal penalty, and one was at sunrise. And that happened more than once.
What he did, which was the first time I had been allowed to experience it, was that he had huge Voice of the Theaters speakers on top of the buildings. And so when he would start the scene and get the understanding of what the reality of that moment was, he'd play the sound score. And Vangelis had already given him some temp stuff. And he'd blast it into the street so that you were working inside of a full ongoing environment of sound and special effects. Spinners were coming up and down, and they had the cranes working, and all the smoke and all the water, and that back lot came alive.
What he was trying to do was just incredible. And I remember we would sit for 8 hours trying to do one setup, and you would do it, like, right? And you could pretty much, what you're seeing in your eyes, what you're gonna see, it's really pretty much that. But then I remember going to dailies, and it's the one film to this day where I went to dailies and I went, we shot that? I was shocked.